Hello everyone, this is Vidisha and today I am going to talk about histone modifications. In this video, I am going to cover the overview of histone modifications where we will see types of modifications and modifiers, general roles of modifications, techniques used to study histone modifications. And specific modifications like acetylation, methylation, phosphorylation we'll talk about, the residues that are frequently modified, enzymes that add or remove the modification, their biological roles, crosstalk between histone modifications, and a probability of histone code. So let us begin. As you can see here, histone undergo post-translational modifications, which includes acetylation, methylation, phosphorylation, ubiquitination, and sumoylation, also ADP ribosylation. And there are particular residues that are there in which these modifications occur. We will see one by one. So why and what are these modifications? These modifications occur, are there any patterns or temporal sequences? How do these modifications translate into mechanism? Whether there is a histone code then? Let us see. So histone modifications, that is a mark or writing a mark to the histone, that is done by writers, enzymes that add a mark to the histone N-terminal tails. Eraser is an enzyme, set of enzymes that remove the mark. Those are deacetylases, demethylases, or phosphatases. Readers are the proteins that read the mark and interpret the mark. Based on that, the function is going to happen. And these reader proteins contain domains like bromodomain, chromodomain, PHT finger, or WT40 repeat. There are multiple modifications that occur on lysine, serine, threonine, and arginine by particular enzymes. For example, histone acetyl transferase is responsible for acetylation of the histone residue, and histone deacetylase is responsible for deacetylating that. Similarly, histone methyl transferase and histone demethylase is responsible for modifying methyl group to the lysine. Ubiquitin ligase and protease is involved for the ubiquitination and deubiquitination of lysine residue. Kinase and phosphatase are there for phosphorylation and dephosphorylation of serine threonine residues of histone. And protein arginine methyl transferase, deiminase demethylase is responsible for methylation and demethylation respectively for arginine residue. For other modifications such as sumoylation can happen to lysine, and ADP ribosylation can happen to glutamate residue of histone. So as you can see, this is the lysine amino acid whose epsilon amino group is then there is a transfer of acetyl group from acetyl CoA to this epsilon amino group. That is how this lysine is modified to acetylated lysine. And this transfer of group can be mono, di, or tri. That means one lysine residue can undergo multiple modifications. This image is to show you that how two ubiquitin residues are attached to H2A histones of a nucleosome. So different dynamics are there for this histone modification, such as acetylation and deacetylation of histone, or phosphorylation or dephosphorylation of histone are highly dynamic, because they are involved in active transcription regulation. But histone methylation of histone are more stable because they usually leads to the formation of heterochromatin like structures and also to replace the transcription. Histone modifiers are the proteins that read the mark or read the modifications. They do not bind to DNA themselves. They can act as transcriptional co-regulators, and they can enhance the activities of transcriptional repressors or activators when they present in a multi-complex group. Specific histone modifications, we'll now see what are those, the positions which are modified, modifying enzymes, and the functions of the modifications. So let us begin with lysine acetylation of the tail or core. So not all the lysines in the exposed N-terminal tails are acetylated. Acetylation occurs in a non-random manner. As you can see, the amino group is being acetylated by histone acetyl transferase, and the acetyl group donor is acetyl CoA. And when this happens, there is a loosening of the nucleosome, because the lysine residue, when gets acetylated, the positive charge is going to remove by acetyl group. That means it is neutralizing the positive charge. Hence, the interaction between the histone and DNA is not so tight there. Hence, the loosening of the nucleosome is happening by acetylation. So there are two different types of histone acetyl transferase, type A and type B. Type A hats localized to nucleus. They mostly acetylate nucleosomal histones in the reactions that are closely related to transcriptional activation. And type B histone acetyl transferases are purified from cytoplasmic fractions. They are responsible for acetylating newly synthesized histones before chromatin assembly. This histone acetyl transferase, acetylate histone H4 at K5 and K12 position, and this is important for the deposition of histone to the nucleosomes. After that, the marks are removed. Type A hats, they remain in a complex structure like this. As you can see, it is not a single enzyme. They remain in a multi-subunit complexes. These proteins, the similarity between these proteins are that they are structurally conserved in the central core, and they can acetylate non-histone proteins. And the differences are there are sequence divergence, their catalytic mechanisms, and the interacting proteins that regulate their specificity. So in histone code, we will now make a list that to which histone, at what position, what modification is happening, and what is the final effect of that modification. By now we know that, so far we know that histone H4, when it is acetylated at K5 and K4, and that affects the initial deposition of the histone. Histone deacetylases, they deacetylate histone tails. They also present in a multi-enzyme complex, and they can be targeted by transcriptional repressors. As you can see, if histone acetyl transferase is responsible for acetylation, there is an opening up of chromatin, and when it is deacetylated, leads to the compaction of chromatin. Histone deacetylases are present in three different classes. You don't have to remember the name of the classes, just remember that sirtuins are the most famous and celebrated enzyme in histone deacetylases, and they also remain in a multi subunit complex like histone acetyl transferases. Coming to the roles of acetylation, so when you have an acetylation of lysine, that reduces the charge interaction of histones with DNA. You can see when lysine was there, there was a positive charge of the histones that was helping in interaction with the negatively charged DNA. but when it is acetylated, that interaction is not happening properly and leads to the loosening of the nucleosome. And also, it prevents, the acetylation prevents the compaction of chromatin, like H4K16 acetylation prevents 30 nanometer fiber formation, as you can see here. So we also know now that H4K16 acetylation prevents 30 nanometer fiber formation. Acetylated isoform of histone can be resolved by electrophoresis. So histones have a high net positive charge. The electrophoresis of them can be done at low pH and they move towards the cathode. Now, for each lysine that is acetylated, the net positive charge is reduced by 1. Now, the histones, because they have less positive charge, will move slowly towards the cathode. The acetylated isoforms of H4 separates particularly well. As you can see here, this is zero acetylation is zero here. Here it is single acetylated residue, double acetylated residue, 3 acetylated residue and 4. So this can well resolved in gel. Now when you treat with deacetylase inhibitors for a particular time, you can see that with increase in time, since deacetylase inhibitor will inhibit the activity of histone deacetylase, so more acetylation will be present on H4. That is why you are detecting these bands, which was not there in the 0 hour. Hence, when you use inhibitors of histone deacetylase, you can study the acetylation of histones. Now, as you can see that when histone deacetylase is present along with transcriptional repressor and corepressor, you have a hypoacetylated histones and condensed chromatin. Hence, in this condition, the transcription will not happen. But when you have histone acetyl transferase and that will acetylate the histones, that will recruit transcriptional activator, and now transcription can happen. Now, the acetylation of the histones recruit chromatin proteins with bromodomain. For example, SWISNF, HATs like GCN5 and P300. These bromodomains will recognize the acetylated histones, and they encode for this human genome encode for at least 56 bromodomains in 42 different proteins. This acetylation or methylation can occur at the same residue. This kind of phenomena is called competitive antagonism. As you can see, histone H3K9 and K27 both can undergo acetylation and methylation at the same residue. When it is acetylated, the chromatin will be said as it is in active state, and when it is methylated, it is in repressive state. Now we know that when K27 and K9 will be acetylated, they undergo activation of transcription, and when K27 and K9 are methylated, they will be repressed. Now we'll see that how this acetylation is highly correlated with active transcription. In this experiment is an outcome of chromatin immunoprecipitation followed by microarray, where you are using antibody against H4 acetylation or H3 acetylation, and then using the pull down, you are looking for transcription start site enrichment. As you can see that in case of H3 acetylation, the enrichment of transcription start site is much more, and these colorful lines are 4 different classes of promoters. And at the same position of this H3 acetylation, you can see that when you pull down using RNA polymerase 2 antibody or TAF1 antibody, it is similarly enriched. That means it is related, the acetylation of H3 or H4 is correlated highly with the active transcription. Again, if you look for any transcription factor binding, in this case we will look for P300 binding site. So now when you pull down using H4 acetylated antibody or H3 acetylated antibody and look for P300 binding site, you see an enrichment in both the cases. That means the position where P300 is binding, H3 acetylation is also more there. And these are the three classes of enhancers shown by different colors here. We will now see lysine methylation of the histone tail or core. Lysine methyl transferases are known as KMTs. These enzymes are very specific. They target a certain lysine or a certain histone, and they can put mono, di, or trimethyl groups. They contain set domains, and the readout is very specific. That means H3K4 methylation versus H3K4 methylation of three groups, generation of these two are very specific by these enzymes. So this lysine methylation will happen by histone lysine methyl transferase, where you can add mono, di, or trimethyl group, and S adenosyl methionine SAM is the methyl group donor in this case. There are readers that contain chromodomain, Tudor domain, MBT domain, and PhD fingers that recognize this methylated lysine residues and then execute the function. Here this is to show you that this is H3 histone chain where the lysine residues are shown in green and in red color. Green color represent active mark and red color represent repressive mark. As you can see for this case that K4 methylation of H3 can be done by this many enzymes, by this many methyl transferases, and the methyl group can be removed by this many demethylases. Similarly for the other lysine groups also. Let us see arginine methylation. So arginine methylation can be symmetric or asymmetric because they have this guanidine group. When you transfer, when the enzyme transfer methyl group, it can be two methyl group to one single nitrogen atom. This time it will be called as asymmetric, and when you have two methyl groups on two different nitrogen atom, it will be called as symmetric dimethyl arginine. And this reaction is done by protein arginine methyl transferase. Protein arginine methyl transferases are the enzymes responsible for arginine methylation. As you can see, they have a conserved domain and they have a SAM binding domain responsible for the transfer of methyl group to the particular histone site that can be symmetric or asymmetric. The demethylation of arginine on lysine can happen. So in case of monomethyl arginine, this is the reaction is through deimination, and the enzyme is PAD4 that generates a citrulline on the histones. That means that is not giving you back the arginine residue. But in case of lysine demethylation, the reaction is amine oxidation carried out by LSD1 enzyme, and you are getting back lysine residue along with 2-formaldehyde as a side product. So K4 methylation is active. When you remove the methylation, it becomes inactive. This is an exception because we generally know that methylation leads to repression and acetylation leads to activation, but that is exception in case of K4. And when K9 is methylated, it is inactive. When you remove the methyl group, it becomes active. This is to show you that in case of promoters, you see that histone 3 K4 methylation, monomethylation, dimethylation and trimethylation. Trimethylation is much more enriched in the transcription start site. But in case of enhancers, you can see that monomethylation is more enriched in case of enhancer region. If you consider the position of if you consider the enhancer region, you will see that the enrichment of the enhancer by K4 monomethyl antibody is much more. There are some roles of histone K4, histone 3 lysine 4 and histone 3 lysine 36 methylation. So K4 methylation is in the eukaryotic promoter that leads to activate transcription, and K36 methylation in the gene or ORF region, that means along the gene, leads to the transcriptional, helps in transcriptional elongation. Hence now we know two more functions of H3K4 methylation is active and K36 methylation is responsible for active elongation. The interaction between DNA methylation and histone acetylation, what is that then? So transcriptionally incompetent heterochromatin is when you have a very low level of histone acetylation and very high level of DNA methylation. That means these will form a heterochromatin. When you have high level of histone acetylation and very low level of DNA methylation, it will be called as competent euchromatin. That happen in case of active genes. But the levels which are there in between, that means the histone acetylation can be inducible, or DNA methylation can be inducible, or it can be removable. In that case, we will call it as transcriptionally inducible chromatin. So remember that transcriptionally inactive DNA will be unmethylated DNA with acetylated histones, and repressed DNA will be methylated DNA with deacetylated histones. We'll now see the other modifications such as serine threonine phosphorylation. So serine threonine phosphorylation plays a role in transcription, mitosis, DNA breaks repair and apoptosis. So H3 phosphorylation by the kinase Aurora B is an hallmark of mitosis. As you can see here that this green mark is for H3S10 phosphorylation, and during mitosis only it is visible. H2AX is a variant of H2A histone, and when the serine is phosphorylated, it is called as gamma H2AX. When you treat with a drug or damaged DNA, there will be generation of gamma H2AX. That means the serine will get phosphorylated. As you can see, when you are treating with drug here, there will be much more phosphorylation of H2AX. But in case of untreated case also, there are some level of phosphorylation of H2AX happen. That is because that is general while replicating DNA, double strand break generation during replication fork stalling, or during recombination event. There are other histone modifications such as ubiquitination at lysine, sumoylation at lysine residue, and ADP ribosylation at glutamate residue. They all play roles in transcription. So coming to crosstalk among modifications, as I already mentioned that H3K9 or H3K27 can undergo acetylation as well as methylation, which you can call as competitive antagonism. When you one modification is there that recruit and modifying enzyme that can place or remove another modification as shown in the figure. Next, the binding of a protein may be disrupted by modification of adjacent position. When at K9 position you have methyl group, HP1 was binding. But when you have H3S10 phosphorylation, this binding of HP1 will be prevented. One complex may contain both methyl transferase and demethylase targeting different residues with opposition function. Consider this figure that in this case it is transcriptionally repressive chromatin. It has methyl transferase also and demethylase also. So PRC2 is methylating K27 which is in repressive mark, and K4 lysine demethylase is removing the methyl mark from K4 which is otherwise active. And next, in this complex you see that methyl transferase MLL2 is transferring the active methyl mark to K4, and K27 demethylation is removing the repressive mark from K27, hence making the transcriptionally active chromatin. Hence, there is a histone code, which is proposed by Stahl and Ellis, which states that multiple histone modification, they act in a combination, a sequential fashion, and that specify unique downstream functions. As you can see that these chromatin states are given in red color indicates more euchromatin-like structure, and blue color indicates more heterochromatin-like structure. As we have seen that K4 methylation or K9 acetylation, this green are a representation of euchromatin or active mark, and these blues are a representation of a repressive mark, that is for heterochromatin. So there are technical advances in the study of histone modification, where you can use histone specific antibodies that you can use for Western blot, immunofluorescence and chromatin immunoprecipitation. As you can see that you can have a specific antibody for against histone H3 lysine 4, H3 lysine 9. That the specific detection of this modification will happen. Also, you can have this antibody to detect in the immunofluorescence studies as shown here. And also you can do chromatin immunoprecipitation, where you can use antibodies specific to modified lysine residue and pull down using that antibody and look for your gene of interest. Thank you.